as a kid, I really loved to play. I loved to play to find out something about the world and what holds it together. Is there some correlation, some connections that I can find? I was sitting there at a bus station, thinking myself, when there will be a red car among the next 5 cars driving, I will be passing the math exam. These kind of connections in my childhood did not really work out. Neither did my math career, unfortunately. And so, as a grown-up, I studied philosophy. And it was tremendous to read about so many people that tried to find out the same things about the world as I wanted to. Like a German philosopher, Johann Gottlieb von Fichte, for example. Yeah? He said, when I know the position of everything in the world, and I know the dynamics of everything in the world, then it might be possible, from my knowledge of the exact position of one small grain of sand somewhere in the desert, to calculate the whole world and the universe. And maybe not even in the present, but also in the past and in the future. And this perspective kept me. And now I'm thinking, and I want to think with you together, could this be possible when we turn on the algorithms, ChatGPT and things like that? Yeah? When we look at that masses of data, yeah? Could we maybe be in a couple of time be able to calculate everything out of the data that we have there? And so, as a kid, I really loved stories. Yeah? And so I want to take you on some stories across the planet, from Canada, Germany, India, and we may end up in Polynesia. I think every good explorer should visit Polynesia at least once. And therefore, let's look at the data. Yeah? There's the German company Statista. They have found out or aggregated for 2021, so 3 years before today, what happens on average in 1 minute on the internet. And they said, okay, in 1 minute on the internet, around 500 hours of video material is uploaded on YouTube. Every minute. We send each other text messages on WhatsApp and Telegram in the amount of 70 million each minute. On dating platforms, we swipe away or we select 2 million people. That's the population of more than Vienna. Every minute. And we send each other 200 million emails every minute that we try to process them. So there is quite a lot of data there. We don't know if it will be enough, yeah? But we will see what the algorithms can do with that. When I look at the beginning of machine learning, there was one story I found quite interesting about the development of language translation models. When I was a teenager, there was some software where you can try to translate from German into English, but this was the maximum then. Yeah? And the result was more a salad of different words, yeah, than something that you can use for proper communication. Nowadays, we can talk rather seamless with copy and paste between Spanish and Turkey, for example. Yeah? And the point was that at the beginning, they tried to work with these translation engines and teach the algorithm pretty much like we teach our kids at school. There were language teachers trying to teach the algorithm syntax, grammar, structure of sentences, everything like that. And this did not really work out. And then the technicians of IBM had a good idea. They said, okay, why do we structure the messy data of language for the algorithm? Let's just trust in the algorithm that the algorithm will find its own language data. And so they went to the Canadian Parliament, because in the Canadian Parliament, the protocols, the minutes of the Parliament were bilingual, English and French. And they just fed up enough material into the algorithm and told him, please find your own structure of language. And in this moment, where we took out the human interference, the algorithm played with the language and learned. And what can the algorithm now see when he looks through the structures of our perception of the world? Was something that I read from New York City. In New York City, there was once upon a time a new mayor, Michael Bloomberg. He made a fortune out of data, and so he was convinced, I can use data to make also the administration of such a city of New York much more efficient and better. And so he hired a very young team, freshly graduated from University of Statistics, and said, please help me to make the administration in a better way. And they just calculated. They were searching for correlations, pretty much like when I was there at the bus stop, but with larger engines there. And they took a look on the public administration for building inspectors. So these building inspectors, they should check on the buildings if there is a problem in fire safety or in stability. And they were just asking the algorithm, feeding it with all the data of the city administration of New York, please tell us what correlates with a fire and what correlates with a collapse or partially collapse of the building the most. And the algorithm, after calculating, said, okay, there is two correlations. The one is the strongest negative correlation, and this is when the building has a permit for exterior brickwork, then the probability that there will be a problem is the lowest. And the second one is the strongest positive correlation, number of police deployment on this address. So the more often the police goes there. And they provided the head of this public administration with the results. And he said, I have no idea what is the causality between exterior brickwork and police deployments on an address. But let's give it a try. And he went on and focused with his on-site inspection plan on just those two criteria. And before that, he had a success rate of on-site inspections of 13%. And after he just followed the advice of the algorithm of the correlations without understanding why, what is the cause behind that, they had a success rate of 70% on those on-site inspections. So maybe the algorithm can, with his own perception, see through some structures and find some correlations that we could not see. Maybe the algorithm also knows something about our secrets. When I was watching some TEDx talks before writing my own, I was quite impressed by a TEDx talk from Glasgow. And I learned from this TEDx talk in Glasgow that scientists, sociologists, psychologists, for years now try to do some research on the effects of the general availability of pornographic websites on the internet. Yeah, porn. And they tried to do it like they do it in medicine. They wanted to form a group, normally of students, because there is a lot of students for public research at universities. They formulated, they formed a group of students that address and go to these websites that consume the porn there. And then they also need a control group of students who do not consume the porn and go on those websites. And on this TED Talk, I learned they have not succeeded in finding enough students for the control group yet. So about one of our most forceful, most personal, most important traces, our sexual traces, science at this field knows not too much. But the tech companies, they can measure the search words. They can measure in their algorithm how long we stay on one page, how often we click, things like that. So it might be that Google and others running the algorithm know much more about that than science, the state, our partners at home, and maybe sometimes also ourselves. But it's just our digital thing. One of the last stops takes us to India. And there is quite a fascinating development going on in India. India has succeeded in less than 10 years to provide 95% of the population with digital biometrical identities, the so-called Aadhaar system. Aadhaar is a Hindi term, means basis or fundament. And what they did is the following. In this Aadhaar system, they store all the data from all the documents that you have in your document file at home. This is also readable for machines out of these documents. They also store all 10 fingerprints. They also store a scan of both of your irises. And they also store a measurement of the morphology of the face. And so, the fascinating thing with this Aadhaar system in India is that you have it on your cell phone, or if you don't have a cell phone, then you have just a printout of a QR code giving you direct access to your Aadhaar number. And this register that they build up is accessible for everyone. So in other countries, like we most of the time also talk about China, yeah, when we see about all those measurements and all the state collecting the data, it's a little bit spooky. Yeah? But in India, they collect a lot of data and make it transparent to everyone. Everyone can access it. The data is accessible like Swedish tax files. And so when I think about the mechanisms of the algorithm and connect it with my desire from my childhood, transparency of data, transparency of people, maybe also transparency of our secrets, might be something that this big algorithm to explain the world to us will need. And if nothing changes, nowadays we are quite on the track to provide all this information, all this knowledge of how the world is set up, of the meaning of the world, of the universe, of everything, like we have read in Hitchhiker's Guide to the Galaxy. Yeah? We are on the way to provide all this to the big tech companies running the algorithms. Maybe there will be some states, yeah? But maybe there is another way. Maybe there's a third way. We could also try to, as a society, provide all our data to everyone. Make it transparent. Make us transparent to everyone. I think this would be quite good and suitable for a democracy. And maybe this idea is not so spooky. There were some mechanisms that we've seen in history. And this is the last stop in Polynesia. There is one interesting loan word in German and English language coming from Polynesia, and this loan word is the word tatau. Tatau is translated into English and German as tattoo. And this word became so popular in the Western languages because on the ships there were a lot of sailors from Polynesia and their whole bodies were covered with very fascinating tattoos. And it was not only the exorcism, yeah, because this comes from a foreign country. These tattoos represent all the important actions and experiences of these people. So whenever there was a coming of age, for example, then there was one tattoo enriched on the skin. When the people married, when they gave birth to kids, for example, when there was a successful trip, a successful hunt, a new friendship. Yeah? Everything was to be readable on the skin. And so maybe for us, when we share all the data, when we become transparent for everyone to commonly find out how to grasp the world and the meaning and the universe and everything, it could be that a second digital skin is running above our real skin. We will see how it develops, but could be that the Tao Tao, this book of life, will be transformed in some kind of book of humankind when we share our data there. So for the next break, give it a try. There are so many people. Huh? Make anything from you transparent. Maybe also tell a secret. Huh? And maybe this is one way how you can contribute that we can all find out how to grasp the world, what are the interconnections, and what holds everything together. Thank you very much.